Thank you for checking out this week's episode of the Giles and the Goalie podcast. If you can, we would like to ask you a couple of favors before we start our otherwise fine podcast this week. First of which is, if you can go to zonecoverage.com/subscribe, use the promo code GATG20, you can get a year's subscription to Zone Coverage for just $20. Gives you access to all of the great content across our website, but more importantly, helps pay for the production of our otherwise fine podcast. If you can't, hey, we get it. The other thing you can do to help us out is, if you're an iTunes listener, go on iTunes and give us a rating, good or bad. It helps us out immensely. Again, that's GATG20 is a promo code for zonecoverage.com/subscribe. Or again, just drop us a rating on iTunes if you listen via that platform. That is all that I ask. Thank you so much for listening again this week, and enjoy the new episode of Giles and the Goalie.
The Zone Coverage Podcast Network.
They may be drinkers, Robin, but they're also human beings.
Hell yeah, let's get stinko.
That team sure did suck last night. They just plain sucked. I've seen teams suck before, but they were the suckiest bunch of sucks that ever sucked.
Giles and the Goalie podcast, back in the Burnsville studios, which has undergone a little bit of a infusion in baby gear since the last time I was here.
The Burnsville Daycare Center, you mean?
Yeah. Burnsville Daycare and Studios.
Yes.
Burnsville Studios and Daycare.
Yes.
Whatever. However you want to say it. There's both. Yeah. It was a... another later in the week pod than usual.
Sorry.
No, that's totally my fault.
True.
you're so quick to... I'm just kidding. It is my fault. I came back Monday from Kansas City, drove back from Kansas City, which, you know, isn't that bad of a drive, except, you know...
Iowa.
We did stop... We did stop in Des Moines both ways. Take a quick break at the sports book in right outside of Des Moines.
Nice.
Yeah, Saturday we did some football, little bit of football wagering, and had one friend did a 3-team parlay card.
Sure.
For the NFL on Sunday, and she picked the winner's right, so my friend Eric thought that she had won the card and won $100. So for roughly an entire day, 24-hour period, we had thought that this like $5 parlay card had been turned into $100, and I was like, "Well, that's pretty fun." Mm-hmm. Another fun experience on a very fun trip, if I may add. Uh-huh. And we get to the casino on the way back. And it was the biggest downer to find out as we're pulling into the driveway. Eric goes, "Oh, I think you had to cover the spread too," which none of the teams did. So the ticket got brought inside, and like, "Oh yeah, you had to cover the spread too."
Yeah, those are two different bets, straight up or versus the spread.
So. Yeah. So that was quite an exciting 24-hour period building up to that sheer disappointment. That's also known as the 24-hour period before a Vikings playoff game. But I'm bumps.
Yeah. Or no? Any Vikings game, really.
Yeah, that's true. But yeah, Kansas City was fun. The judge's plate recommendation at Q39 was very on point. Yeah. I legitimately went into a food coma for 2 hours after that. Between brisket, pulled pork, and...
Ribs. Yeah.
That was delicious. And
I played it smart when I was there. We had it for lunch on Sunday, and immediately flew home.
Yeah.
So you had it on Saturday night, and that
we still had days. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, we. You know, the night kind of gets hazy after that, to be honest. But
maybe you did just fall asleep.
No, we did go check out a few other places, but sure. we did have to keep it within reason. We had to get up early the next morning and go to the football game because that was another experience unto itself. Because there's a giant parking lot where people can tailgate, which is
what a concept.
Very very fun. Literally everyone was grilling some form of barbecue, mm-hmm. which the smell of the parking lot was mm-hmm. amazing. Mm-hmm. And then roughly like every three cars, they had their own set of cornhole boards. Mm-hmm. So they're all playing bags. And that was very fun. Mm-hmm. Oh, and then I got to see Pat Mahomes.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if you care or not, but you haven't introduced us or the podcast.
Wow.
Is this a record?
That's 4 minutes.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Yeah, I went to Burnsville Studios, mm-hmm. tried to decide studios or daycare, mm-hmm. which went first. Oh, yeah, and then I just straight went into
Kansas City.
I was so excited.
I don't blame you. Kansas City's great. I have a friend that lives down there and visit there, not as much as I'd like, of course, but it's a cool little town.
That is the voice of Ben Remington.
Hello.
I am Giles Farrell. This is the Giles and the Goalie podcast. That set the record for longest introduction into the
first
podcast.
First time listeners would be like, this is a barbecue podcast? What the hell did I listen to?
This is a Chiefs barbecue podcast? I've turned on the wrong channel.
Not inaccurate, actually, I got to say. That's a very fair point if you think that.
Yeah, but my last thought on Kansas City was... If you are considering going down there for the Vikings game,
oh wow!
When they play early November, I highly encourage you to do so. As long as you are, you know, respectful within reason, and you're just having fun with the fans there, they will treat you very well. Unless you are being an absolute knob, like one Texans fan was. Then you will not be treated as well. So,
oh, well, that's, yeah.
Yeah, don't be a knob. Like, that's just the point. Don't be a knob. So, yeah, it was an amazing experience, and I am considering going again later this year.
I don't blame you.
That was the extent of my weekend hiatus and why our podcast is late. 6 minutes later, we get to the actual... meat of the podcast. The brisket of the podcast.
There it is. And I said wow because we just saw Luke Cunningham score. We were watching the Wild and Leafs game live, so enjoy the first hour-ish of that in semi, well, not live to you, I guess, but live commentary as we digest the Wild playing the exciting Leafs team.
Yeah, I cannot believe that the Wild are out to a 1-0 lead, especially after Monday's game, which was just an absolute snooze fest.
Yeah, it was brutal. You kind of expect that playing the Senators because it's the Senators. But man, I mean, did that game live up to its billing or what? Holy crap.
Yeah.
That was a...
the toilet bowl.
Yeah, I mean, I know it's... whoa, I know it's daytime hockey, but man, was that... that was hard to stay awake through.
On Canadian Thanksgiving of all days, so if you were already sleepy after having some turkey up there in Canada, you no doubt were put to bed with that wonderful performance.
Our poor three Canadian listeners. Yeah, I mean, and not to mention, like, so I get it. You know, it's kind of like their football. Like, we watch football on Thanksgiving, they watch hockey. That totally makes sense. But to get the Wild and the Senators, I mean, like, what's the football? It's got to be, like, Redskins-Dolphins, right? Like, we just had last week for the NFL. Like, that's got to be, like, getting that game, right?
Right.
Where you've got one team where you're not really sure what direction they're going in, but they should probably rebuild. And that's, you think, where they're headed. And then you've got the other team with the worst owner in the league by a million miles and are crappy because of it. I mean, that's super, a super easy parallel, right?
Right. The weird thing about this was... there were Canadian games, obviously, but there was just straight up American teams playing in the afternoon.
I know. It was weird.
Which was really weird. And
I mean, I know it's mostly Canadians on those teams, but still.
Right. Just as weird as Canadians going to the White House.
They play for a team here, Giles.
Yeah, we're going too far. Another blah week from the Minnesota Wild. Kind of newsworthy things that we kind of wanted to touch on here on this show. The first of which is this came to light, you know, it was really put into light after the win against Ottawa, but you kind of started to see this come out after the loss to Pittsburgh on Saturday night in the home opener, mm-hmm. which I believe was the first straight-up loss by the Wild in regulation in their history at the home opener.
No, it was the first one in like 10 years, though. They've lost home openers before.
Well, right. They've lost, but I always thought they lost in like overtime or whatever. I could be wrong. I thought
maybe
they had
only one other time, I think. Right. I think I saw like 10-1-4 or something.
Yeah,
like
it was
that.
Something like that. But anyway, basically, I think it was like Ryan Suter who echoed after that Pittsburgh game that they need to start winning games like 2-0, 2-1, and then it became a rallying point after the 2-0 win in Ottawa, which had your everyday occurrence of a Victor Rask game-winning goal and Alex Stalock shutout.
Yeah, of course. That's how you draw it up.
But I am not a big fan of pushing that they need to win, you know, 2-0 or whatever, you know, basically not giving up more than 2 goals per game this early in the season, you know, or really in general for that matter, because you are basically saying as a team, and this is something the coaching staff also echoed, yeah, we cannot score. So basically, goaltenders, it's on you to make sure that we can stay in games.
So I'm a new dad / retired blogger, and I missed this. Who is actually like saying this? Like somebody's actually pushing this as something the team should shoot for?
I know for sure that was something that Ryan Suter said, and then this was a couple other players after the game on Monday, and the head coach.
What?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, yeah, ideally you want to let up less than 2 goals. What kind of freaking idiot? Okay. Yeah, I don't see any kind of wisdom in that. Like, that's putting way too much pressure on Devan Dubnyk, who has just really, you know, I don't want to say his game is eroded, but he really has, you know, kind of fallen by the wayside, where I remember a couple of seasons ago we were talking about him being kind of a really borderline top 10 goaltender. And I don't think it's really unfair to say he's a solid bottom 10 goaltender at this point. I think that's very, very fair to say. So, yeah, that's just putting... And then you've got Alex Stalock, who, yes, shut out against the worst team in hockey aside, is not a competent NHL backup goaltender.
That's the football equivalent of Adrian Peterson rushing for 110 yards against the Miami Dolphins.
Yeah, it really is.
37-year-old Adrian Peterson, mind you, running for 110 yards against the Miami Dolphins.
Yeah, that's just putting way too much pressure on your goaltending. Like, why would you say something like that? Again, yeah, you're crapping on your forwards because you're essentially admitting that they can't get it done and that you need to score, you know, you need to let up less than 2 goals. And then you're like basically, yeah, telling your goalie's like, well, yeah, if you don't keep more than 2 out, we're SOL. So I don't see what you gain from saying something like that publicly. That just makes zero sense.
And also, what year are we in? Is this 1997?
Right.
As the Jacques Lemaire trap returned?
Oh, right. Well, we got to tighten up the trap out there, boys.
What? Why? Like, this is just disaster and, you know, red alert, but this just seems to me like they're just ready to become unhinged already at this point. And, well, like, putting that much pressure on your goaltenders who did not have a good year last year by any stretch of the imagination, is just, you're asking for it. And, you know, yes, the Wild have a good defense, and they are really good at suppressing shots, you know, to outside the high danger area. They However, were. That did not stop the Wild goaltenders last year from being brutal.
Yeah.
Still in those types of situations.
Mm-hmm.
And so you really have to, you know, kind of, you have to choose your words carefully, especially with this team. Like, this is the most, like, moody up and down group that I really can see in this sport. And to put that kind of pressure on your goaltenders is ridiculous. Now, Alex Stalock, apparently beloved by everyone in the locker room. Great, great guy.
You know, I've
which,
heard that.
Which, sidebar, I have a bone to pick with this. I knocked Stalock last week, which somebody basically, like, quote tweeted and said, this tweet didn't age well after his shutout
yesterday. Freezing
cold
takes.
Yeah. Old takes exposed.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, Alex Stalock is not a good backup goaltender, and he has to be a good locker room guy. It's like the Paul Fenton GM thing. He can be the lousiest person, but he has to be good at his job. If you have a lousy person and lousy at your job, then yeah, that's why you're getting the foot out the door.
Right.
So, yeah. Alex Stalock has to be a good person, because otherwise he's probably in Iowa or not even in the organization.
He's definitely at least in Iowa, if not somewhere worse.
So I don't like that rhetoric of, oh, he's a great guy, like the locker room would fall apart. Well, the locker room's going to fall apart at some point anyway. Just it's rearranging deck chairs on the Titanic.
It really is.
Another a time-honored phrase of this podcast. I am just... Nothing good came out of... from quotables or stories in the last week. And that's really just the start of it, is basically saying we have to win 2-1 or 2-0. And you're basically going to ask to do that against the Toronto Maple Leafs. Say the Wild hold this lead until, like, one, the third, and then they just shell up.
Yeah.
That's a recipe for disaster against the Toronto Maple Leafs. They right. score a lot of goals.
Yeah.
Don't know if you know that.
Yeah, we'll see how this one turns out.
Yeah, watch that age terribly.
Right. well, so I think we're burying the lead here. I think we're forgetting the most important Wild news of the week, Giles. I don't know. Can we play Casey and the Sunshine Band Celebrate? Is that something that do we have copyright issues with that?
Probably.
Okay. Because something historic happened this weekend at the home opener. Something changed with the Minnesota Wild.
Oh. Oh my God.
And yes. I just want to
yes,
take.
Yes, we have to push this. This is our good news of the week.
I just want to take personal credit and tell the entire state of hockey.
I'm just going to drop it in anyway.
You're welcome for forever changing the course of the Minnesota Wild by single-handedly getting rid of the Let's Go Wild chant. And now apparently the Wild have seen the error in their ways. They have determined that Wild is, in fact, a one-syllable word. And the chant is now Let's Go Wild, with an emphasis on Wild. An emphasis on one syllable Wild, and Nordy is leading said chant in that fashion.
That's beautiful. That's a beautiful sight.
I don't know how to even put into words how happy I am about
God,
this.
That was such a I got that at Q39 eating that barbecue. So that was such a beautiful dinner of barbecue and the fact that Wild had been retired.
Yeah, no, that's just I'm equally happy and blown away, because I can't believe that they would actually do that.
Right. It It seemed like a time-honored tradition, like the state of hockey song in between the first and second period.
Yeah, no, it really did. I mean, did we get word? Did they do the state of hockey song? Like, maybe is there like?
I honestly don't know.
Is there a possibility that they got rid of that as well? Because that would. I mean, I feel like that would kind of be two for two. What else did we want to get rid of with them?
Let's see. We got rid of red jerseys.
Sure.
Wild is gone.
Yep. Oh, crowd chant.
Crowd chant's still there.
Yeah, that's still there.
Wait. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
We're still waiting.
Well, you know, you can't. Oh, the number one banner.
Yeah.
You know, you got to. Well, so you can't win them all.
Yeah.
But damn it, we're making progress.
Yeah. We're getting there.
Yeah.
We are truly building a better state of hockey on this podcast.
What if the Wild thing was Bill Guerin's call? Like, what if that was, he heard it
he's like,
at the first home game, was like, what the hell is that?
What, you used
that's
two
not a
syllables?
Two-syllable word? Like, what?
What are you
what's,
doing?
What's wrong with you? Are you teaching? Is this a Grey Duck thing? What the hell is going on here? And what if he just, like, shot it down because he was so appalled by the use of two syllables?
Yeah, he. That has to be.
I already like him better than Paul Fenton.
Yeah. Certifiably. He's better. Not crazy at all.
Right.
Speaking of crazy.
Hey.
Or no, not crazy. Speaking of Bill Guerin, that's what I wanted to say.
Oh, sure.
I could be reading into this way too much, but there was a story out of the Athletic Pittsburgh division. Which was on Bill Guerin, you know, basically how he had wanted the Pittsburgh GM job, kind of seemed to be the GM in waiting with Jim Rutherford inching his way towards retirement, but then took the Wild job, for which he is, of course, very happy to be a part of now.
Of course.
And it was good that he didn't wait for the Penguins job.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I could just be oversensitive, and as I approach a milestone age here this week, I could just be getting very grumpy, but what is the point of this story? Like, basically, like, are you trying to put fear in me that as soon as Jim Rutherford retires, Bill Guerin wants to jump ship and move to the oh my God, he wants to jump ship and move to the Penguins.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's been here a hot minute, and wow, it's so bad. He's been here literally 1 month, and he wants out. No, I'm just kidding there. But what is the point of that?
I think there's, I don't know.
I have a grind to pick with Pittsburgh media just in general.
Yeah,
they're all kind of knobs, but
yeah, that's true.
What that just doesn't seem like something that really appeals to Wild fans to read, and Pittsburgh fans are like, oh, okay, I guess this guy's just getting his feet wet, then coming back again.
Maybe
I'm paranoid.
And
if I'm
maybe
paranoid, tell me I'm wrong.
I didn't read the article, but maybe that's the angle they're going with. But, you know, also you have to consider too, because, like, there was a funny article or just the funny concept that somebody actually wrote. So there's a local writer, and it wasn't one of the usual hacky ones. It was a hacky one, but not one of the usual hacky ones. That wrote, leading up to the Twins and Yankees series, about how a certain celebrity had a soft spot for the Twins, even though he's a native New Yorker. And this celebrity was Joe Piscopo.
Who?
Yeah. Joe effing Piscopo. The guy that you only know because he was on SNL for 17 minutes, did a pretty good Frank Sinatra opposite Eddie Murphy's very good Stevie Wonder impression. But yeah, you know, during the very, very forgettable 80s SNL, Joe Piscopo was there. He was present. And so this local writer wrote a story about him having a soft spot for the Twins despite being a born and bred New Yorker, Yankees fan, etc. The point that I'm getting at, aside from the comedy that just is the fact that somebody wrote a freaking article about Joe Piscopo in the Twin Cities, the point that I'm getting at is that sometimes writers and, you know, columnists and lazy newspaper types take the path of least resistance. And that's kind of what that Guerin story feels like to me. Clearly this writer had a good connection with Guerin. Clearly this writer had some kind of comfort level and, you know, reached out, "Hey, Bill, you know, how is it going? How are things in Minnesota? Blah, blah, blah." And you know, what asked him the questions that related to Pittsburgh, because he's a Pittsburgh writer, so of course he's going to ask him the questions that relate to Pittsburgh. And he just wrote them down. He just wrote down the conversation, and Guerin said, "Yeah, you know, maybe I was the GM in waiting there, but I felt like it was a good opportunity for me and time to leave, and et cetera, et cetera." You know, GM speak, GM speak, GM speak. But I just see it as this writer just taking some stuff that he had from a conversation with Bill Guerin. Like, it's not, I don't know that there's necessarily an angle there, but it's just easy. It was just an easy article to write. And, you know, I guess you and I have been guilty of that in the past too on occasion, maybe. Sometimes you just take something that's easy to write. And sometimes just putting out content is something that you have to do because of your contract, or because you feel like it's been too long since you've written something, or whatever. But that's just, you know, what ends up happening. That's just kind of how it turns out. And that's just what I see this article as. I don't see it as any kind of guarantee that Bill Guerin jumps ship as soon as Jim Rutherford retires. But, I mean, hey, maybe that absolutely is the case, I guess. It wouldn't shock anybody, I don't think, given the state of this hockey team. But, I mean, you talk about a bad situation. If Bill Guerin leaves this team kind of, you know, high and dry, mid, I don't know if you want to call it a reload or whatever the hell they're going for, but I mean, that really becomes a very unattractive job when a GM who may or may not have his crap together just up and leaves for his former employer.
Yeah, again, I could be completely off my rocker here, and it just seemed like this, what is the point of this, especially from a Minnesota perspective trying to read this, but again, it's out of Pittsburgh, so who knows? That was a something I had to air out on the show. And other kind of things to hit on here this week: Kevin Fiala, Ryan Donato scratched.
Mm-hmm.
Victor Rask, of course, getting into the lineup with the game-winning goal on Monday. Are you of the belief that, you know, this is a sanctioned thing to do by scratching younger players who seemingly have more skill, or are you concerned that this is being done?
It's hard not to be concerned because of who those players are and what they kind of mean. We talked about it before the season. What is the most important thing for the Wild this year? What's the key? And those were two guys that I mentioned, Fiala and Donato. So, yeah, it's concerning. I mean, because the thing is, you know, I don't think it's anything that's, like, sent down from above. I don't think Guerin has it out for Paul Fenton guys. I don't think that's the case because, you know, he's got no reason to hold grudges against those guys. But most importantly, I mean, I do kind of wholeheartedly believe that the lineup is Bruce Boudreau's to control. And, you know, for the most part, I guess I should say. And he doesn't feel like these guys are playing well. And that part of it is very concerning. I mean, it's especially when you consider you traded Mikael Granlund and Charlie Coyle for those guys. And those were guys that, you know, you're almost never going to see healthy scratched. I think maybe Coyle was once. I don't even know if he was, come to think of it.
He probably was once, and yeah, like I know Niederreiter was early on in his tenure.
Yeah, yep.
But
I don't know that, I'm sure Granlund never was. And I don't know that Coyle was, and if he was, and it was a one-time deal, and it was maybe a get-your-head-straight kind of thing, and certainly, you know, or whatever. But anyway, you're scratching those guys, you know, for, I mean, the Victor Rasks of the world, which you know what you're getting, and it's not particularly great, and now you're scratching those guys for and we can talk about the great Jerry Mayhew. You know, a lot of success in Iowa, but, you know, not necessarily somebody that
gonna be a world beater.
Gonna be a savior of the franchise by any stretch. So yeah, that's definitely bad news. I mean, when we talked about what this team needed to go forward, what this team needed to have a successful season to make the playoffs, and it was essentially, you know, a few of or all of those guys stepping up, and that was Fiala, Donato, Cunnan, Greenway were kind of the focus four guys, I felt like. And now you got half of them, you know, not playing well enough to literally freaking lace the skates. Yeah, that's a problem. That's a big problem.
I wasn't enthused with Donato's scratch. I think that was Saturday, I believe, against Pittsburgh was when he was scratched. And, you know, especially against a team like Pittsburgh that's going to come at you with so much skill. And,
right.
You know, when you're just subbing out Donato for Victor Rask, you know, that's just, it just feels like you're asking for it. And, you know, yeah. Rask is obviously mad that he's been scratched for the first four games of the year, and who wouldn't?
No.
But my concern is, I don't doubt that he's going to be motivated to play. My concern is, can he keep up with the opposition out on the ice? It's a legitimate concern, yeah. And when you're scratching young players who have the potential of skill, you know, it does open up a can of worms, and you know, something I think you do need to consider if there is concerns with Ryan Donato from the coaching staff is you still have just a handful of games left where he can go to Iowa and be waiver exempt.
Sure.
So if you still have that opportunity and you feel like he needs a shot in the arm of confidence, just get him quality ice time and, you know, just breathe offense in Iowa, do that while you still can. That was a legitimate concern I had with the previous regime, not the last regime.
Sure.
The one before.
Right.
Where they would just let the waiver clock run out, and then you're kind of stuck with these guys, and you really can't do anything with them when they're struggling, but you're not going to get them up in the lineup because you're front-loaded with veterans.
Right.
So getting Ryan Donato down in Iowa for, you know, maybe a little bit of time would do some good. I don't believe Kevin Fiala is a waiver exempt anymore. So he's one you just kind of have to deal with it
right.
on the fly. But it also is a concern of mine that you have Bruce Boudreau kind of playing to win in the now. Because he's in the last year of a contract. And maybe, I know a few people have thrown this out there, but maybe it is a good idea just to tack on another year to his deal as head coach just to give him maybe a little bit more comfort level that he doesn't feel like he has to win in the now to maybe get a new contract. And play a Victor Rask over a Ryan Donato or Kevin Fiala, players who the Wild desperately need to find their true potential, their game-breaking potential with the team.
Yeah, I think it's tough because it's like that might be on Bruce. No, it's not on Bruce. It's on Bill. It's on Guerin because so kind of, it seems like, and you know, I don't know if this is true or not, but seems like Bruce is coaching to win now, which you would understand. And, but is that because he's trying to save his job? Is that because he wants an extension to keep coaching? Or is that because that's what he's being instructed to do? We don't know that. So it becomes like this question where, what does Bruce want? What is Bruce doing? And is Guerin on the same page as him? Because it's like, Bruce shouldn't have to be coaching for his job if the idea is to kind of play the long game. if Bill Guerin wants Bruce to play the young kids, you know, to get them experience, to get to see what he has in those young kids, then Bruce shouldn't be held responsible for losing games when you've got Fialas and Donatos out there not playing particularly well, you know, but gaining experience. And so it's like, it's this weird, you know, you're in this weird middle ground where you don't really know what the team is doing. You don't really know what the front office is doing. You don't even know what the coach is doing. What are they doing? Are they playing the long game? Are they trying to send a message to these kids, but then playing them? It's not like they're benching veterans, you know, so they're not playing, right. They're not playing the super long game. They're not benching Eric Staal, even though he's noticeably slowed and kind of a defensive liability, like we talked about last week. You know, they're not benching, you know, they're not scratching Mikko Koivu saying, hey, you know, Mikko's coming off of knee surgery. He could use a night off. So what are they doing? Like, are they just, in fact, trying to win each and every game at all costs? Is that the game plan right now? And we don't know. We don't know that. And so it becomes kind of a weird, you know, nexus where we don't know what Bruce wants to do. We don't know what Bill wants to do with Bruce.
There's a lot of uncertainty right now with the organization, and that I think that maybe can be kind of a perfect segue into our mailbag, because the first question on the mailbag is kind of something that I kind of more want to pick at for the uncertainty.
Yeah,
so the Giles and the Goalie mailbag, we asked some questions on, or we asked for some questions on Twitter.com. This was, the first one we had was actually one we got last week from a listener, kind of wondering if it was like more article worthy or podcast worthy, but we'll get to it on here, and might be something I go a little bit more in depth with down the road. But for right now, the question is from Michael Brennan. He asks, are the Wild the worst team in the league at drafting and developing top six forwards? And there's good thought to this. There's a good, you can logically come to that. And I don't have the exact, you know, draft picks right in front of me, but you think, even if you just stay within this decade, you start at 2010 and you run down the line, and even in the last decade, you know, the Wild have not been a good team at just drafting and developing, period. The Doug Risebrough era was just clouded in first round bust after first round bust. And if you try to get a little more recent, you stay within this decade, you know, the Wild haven't exactly done a great job at getting the most out of players with potential, you know, from the forward position and making them comfortable in the top six. You had Mikael Granlund, who was a surefire top six forward, but that was only after he got moved out of the center spot to the wing.
Right.
Charlie Coyle wasn't technically their draft pick, but he still played, I think it was 2 years in college and juniors before he came to the team. And, you know, he got shuffled around the lineup, you know, more times than a, you know, than a deck of cards at a casino.
Right.
I really fumbled with that analogy. you know, if you even just narrow the field to just, like, goal-scoring forwards, who you could say are legitimately top six players.
Zucker.
Jason Zucker. And it took a while for them to finally, you know, get him to take off, but he is very good.
Mm-hmm. That's about it.
That's really it since Marian Gaborik. And
yeah,
you kind of think, you know, every team in the league has had, you know, at least a decent goal-scoring top six forward that they've been able to draft and develop. You know, it, you know, certainly within the last 15 years and almost certainly the last, you know, 10 years, this decade.
Yeah.
So I do think there is a credence to that question that yes, the Wild are probably the worst team at drafting and developing top six forwards. And this is kind of where I was leading into the segment with, was I would love to know, like, what is Bill Guerin's draft plan?
Yeah.
Because this is something he has already, that's probably one of the first things he had to do, was to plan out his draft strategy. Because he has to send the scouts out, because hockey's pretty much all getting underway now across the board.
Right.
So, like, you have to send out your scouts, you know, and you have to have a plan for, you know, who do you want to scout, mm-hmm. how much do you want to scout, you know. Yep. That all had to be planned out pretty much the day he set foot in the executive offices.
Yeah.
So I would love to know, like, what is his strategy, because from Doug Risebrough to Chuck Fletcher, there was just not a whole lot of drafting and developing top six forwards, and Chuck Fletcher really had a love of those forwards who have a ceiling of middle six, two-way forward, but nothing, you know, kind of a higher risk, higher reward type of a player.
Yeah.
And Paul Fenton's limited run, you know, remains to be seen how his two drafts pan out. We certainly have thought highly of those picks outside of his first one, but, you know, we remains to be seen. And so I am generally curious what his strategy is. And the guy running the draft table for the Wild under Paul Fenton was his son, PJ, who is still with the team in the same capacity.
Talk about awkward.
Yeah, do you think there's just awkward, like, water cooler talk? Hey, how's your dad?
Remember when your dad was a dick and got himself fired because he was such a dick? No, you're absolutely right. It's Jason Zucker and it's Marion Gaborik, and I don't think they have a legitimate top six. I mean, you know, we love Mikko Koivu on this podcast. We're Koivu apologists, and
you can certainly
make the argument that for a long time he was a top six forward. For a long time, he was a very good second-line center-type player. So, I guess depending on how you phrase the question, was he a top-six guy? Yes. So, even if you add him to the list, it makes the list maybe slightly less impressive, but it is what it is. Yeah, you've got Gaborik, you've got Koivu, and you've got Zucker, and that's it. The rest are this murky, you know, middle-six, Charlie Coyle, kind of what you did screwing around with Nino Niederreiter, Mikael Granlund, I guess. You know, I guess in the long run, Mikael Granlund was one too.
Yeah.
I think he's, you know, again, maybe he kind of waters down that list a little bit, but it was kind of in spite of themselves. Like you said, they had to move him to wing in order to free him up to make use of his skills. So, yeah, that, I mean, that's absolutely, I think, a fair argument. Granted, they haven't had quite the history of some hockey teams who maybe haven't developed a good forward in just as long, but have a longer history. But I think that should absolutely be a focus. And now you've got players in the pipeline like, you know, let's just say Kirill Kaprizov, who could very well be a top six guy. Certainly a lot of love towards Matt Boldy.
Matt Boldy, yeah.
Their first-round pick this year, who everyone thinks can be kind of that real, you know, real solid top six, you know, power forward type winger. But, you know, you look at picks like Luke Cunningham, Joel Eriksson-Ek, Jordan Greenway, you've got more of the same. You've got more of that middle six type player where are they a top six guy? I mean, yeah, kind of, but should they be? They probably wouldn't be on some teams. So I think it's a great point to make.
Yeah, so again, that'll be something I'll probably revisit down the road and try to maybe go a little bit more in depth with, you know, notable players on each team who've been picked and cross-reference that with whom the Wild have taken. And I really have to be in the right frame of mind, because that's a really dark place to go when you're when you're going down the rabbit hole of Wild draft history, and then you start looking at other players that have been taken after the Wild have made certain picks. That's a really dark place that you don't want to get stuck in.
Yeah, the only team that comes to mind that I think you can say hasn't is probably the Coyotes.
That's probably fair.
Clayton Keller is very good. I like him, but other than that, it's like I don't think they have. But, I mean, kind of proves our point, right? Because anytime you're comparing your hockey team in any way, shape, or form to the Arizona Coyotes, that's bad. So, kind of.
Yeah,
it kind of proves the point. I mean, if you're not the worst, you're the second worst to them, and it's like, well, yeah.
Brian Reynolds asks again, why?
Well, you see, Brian.
Yeah, we're still here.
Yeah,
they still employ us.
Right.
Talk to our employers.
Right.
Aaron Anderson asks, Wild MVP right now, Stalock or Rask?
Right now, I mean, in seriousness, right now, I don't know how it's not Matt Dumba. I mean, just seeing, you know, every time he's on the ice, it feels like the Wild have a chance to score, especially on the power play, which why he's not out there on the power play being run ragged on the power play is beyond me. But you see the difference in that team with Matt Dumba on the ice. And you know, Jason Zucker's probably a very close second. But just, it's so different with Dumba out there.
Yeah, you took the words right out of my mouth. I was going to say, I'm probably going to go with Jason Zucker. He's been really the lone bright spot at forward for the Wild so far.
Yeah.
This season. And on pace for 32 goals, which would smash my 28-goal projection. So
nice.
doing just fine in that regards. But honestly, you know, we just talked about Zucker as being one of the lone draft picks this decade that the Wild have turned into a legitimate top six forward. And yeah. It's just also so hard not to root for the guy.
Oh, God, yeah.
After last year, just the terrible year that he had to endure just on a mental level. Like, yeah. You know, I don't think we fully appreciate like how much like hockey players and, you know, athletes in general, like the travel they do during the season. You know, I read a thing yesterday on ESPN. This is a weird sidebar, but you know, just about like the NBA players and a big kind of underlying problem that the NBA has with their players is they're all sleep deprived. And then my mind kind of wandered. I'm like, gee, I wonder if the NHL has a similar problem because they have very similar schedules.
It's all the cocaine, actually.
At least it's not. Could be worse. Could be MLB and their rampant opioid problem.
Yeah, I suppose.
But no, like you think, you know, the NHL and NBA have very similar schedules. You know, yeah. A lot of back-to-backs, a lot of miles traveled. You know, and these guys, you know, say games start at 7 p.m. local time. And, you know, you're not getting out of the arena until 11:30. Then you got to get on a flight around midnight. And, you know, you're traveling a couple hours. And then you finally hit your bed at, you know, 3:30 in the morning, wherever right. you're going. And then you have a morning skate at, like, 10 a.m. So it just, sleep just seems to be a premium for these athletes. So it just, I don't think we all fully appreciate, you know, all that they have to go through, and then you add to that the mental stress that the Zuckers had to go through with the fact that Jason was almost traded not once, not twice, but three times in the span of like 7 months. That's a toll, and so it is very hard not to root for them, and my tweet Saturday night was very, very well liked, uh-huh. mind you, about every time Jason Zucker scores, a middle finger is raised in memory of Paul Fenton. That was the Q39 old fashioned that was talking there.
Oh, well, that's nothing wrong with that.
Oh, it was delightful, too. That also put me into the coma. But so, long answer, Jason Zucker.
Okay.
Did we switch? Like, I'm so long-winded today.
You're fired up. You're recharged. From a long weekend of rest and relaxation in Kansas City, certainly
could
no.
have been all the coffee I inhaled at work today.
Could, yeah, it's free, so yeah. That helps. Yeah.
It's good though.
Yeah.
Anyway, then the other question we had in the mailbag was from our friend Ohi Tony
uh-huh.
on Twitter. He asks, "Would you trade to free Casey Mittelstad from the Sabres? What would you think is a fair swap?"
Oh, and us.
It's really hard for me to look at this with a a neutral lens.
Without maroon and gold glasses
right,
on?
Without my my gopher tinted visor on. But I you know, I no doubt would try to free him from that's a terrible goal.
Yeah.
That's a terrible goal. John Tavares just took a shot from like the half wall essentially.
Short side.
It just God, we talk about garbage goals earlier, but anyway, I think whether center or wing, the Wild need more young players, and Casey Mittelstadt is a very good, very young player, and hasn't necessarily gone up to snuff in Buffalo as of yet. But if you're the Wild, you got to be sniffing around players who are maybe kind of
buy low,
roadblocked essentially on their teams, and maybe get them at a little bit of a cheaper cost. Yep. And I it's so hard for me to play this game of what do you think is fair, but I wouldn't mind dipping into the bag of the Wild defense to to sacrifice a defense, maybe not Matt Dumba, but sacrifice a defenseman for Casey Mittelstadt. It is Jonas Brodin someone the Sabres would have interest in? Maybe.
I think he would be.
That might be fair, but I don't know. I'd have to look a little bit more into that, and I should probably start watching the Sabres. They're off to another hot start this year, but yeah, probably, I would try to maybe get Buffalo to take a defenseman, because they seemingly have a good offense and they could use a a defenseman. So I would start there and see where it goes.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I I'm terrible at figuring out what the cost would be. Is it a guy like maybe Kevin Fiala is a guy that you move, depending on it all really depends on what the GM Buffalo thinks. If you're aiming for a specific guy like that.
Right.
A specific guy like Casey Mittel said, it's not like, hey, what can we get for Jonas Brodin from anyone? Well, no, it's what can you get from Buffalo? And so it really depends. Like, maybe that GM is the biggest Jonas Brodin fan in the world, and he would give you Mittelstadt and then something for Jonas Brodin, which would be great. Maybe that GM has been talking to Paul Fenton for some reason and thinks that Kevin Fiala is God. Like, we don't know. I think it's a good buy low idea. Casey Mittelstadt, certainly talented, certainly very talented. And I think any time you can add talent to your team, especially very young talent like him, he's still only, 21 right now? So it's like, worth a shot, but again, probably not something that's going to happen, and really tough for us to kind of even really be objective on with our maroon and gold colored glasses. So that makes it kind of tough. I mean, those hypotheticals are fun, but they're just that, they're hypotheticals.
I mean, he would fit in very well here in the fact that he can't win in the playoffs at the X.
I thought you were going to say he's Minnesotan like Alex Stalock.
Oh.
He's a great guy. He knows the area very well. He could give like tours to players who aren't from Minnesota. That's useful, apparently.
God, people from Duluth just love to get in my mentions when Alex Stalock remotely does good.
Yeah, just point to the overall. You can't look
point
at
to the body of work.
Yeah, you can't look at one game, people. That's not how that works.
All right, well, before we go down the Alex Stalock rabbit hole again, we should just probably call it a show. I think we're hitting our mark for Captain Tom, so
I had one last question, and this is something that we haven't done a good enough job of, food debates. So I had a situation today. I did some leadership training downtown Minneapolis. I was at an account or at a building where one of our sister companies has a catering account, whatever. They say, oh, hey, we're bringing in lunch for you guys. It'll be here at X time. What they got for lunch for us was a baked potato bar. So, granted, and I'll give them a little bit of credit, these baked potatoes were huge. It was probably like, more than a fist. It was very, very big baked potatoes. And they had great fixings for them. It was a great baked potato bar. Bacon, chili, cheese, sour cream, butter, all of it. Great stuff. But that was it. That was the extent of what they offered me for a lunch.
Chives?
I don't believe there was chives.
Oh, okay.
No, I believe there was chives.
Yeah, I'm already out on this.
Yeah, so I wanted to, because, you know, you are infamous for wanting to eat a side dish as a meal. And the baked potato was like the classic side dish,
Yeah.
It's like in...
The baked potato is the definition of a side
dish. It's like a Hall of Fame side dish, yeah. Right?
That's like the Wayne Gretzky of side dish.
It is. It's up there. I mean, if you're a steakhouse, you don't make a baked potato, you probably don't stick around for very long. But that's all I had for lunch. And of course, you know, my lovely wife disagreed with me when I came home because she is all about... I think she was all about the bar because it's so many options there, and that's kind of fun to her. And food doesn't matter as much to her, like the actual fillingness of it, as long as it's fun. But I'm just like, I get home at 4 p.m. or whatever, and I am hangry and effing starving to beat the band and have to fire a hot dog down my yap because all I had for lunch was a goddamn baked potato.
Now... I will say in Roz's defense, when you said bar, I just thought of so many more fixins than what you just laid out. So I was like, oh, this is no problem. Well, but then when you listed out the literal five fixins that they had for you.
There was a little bit more than that. Okay, So there was a few more things. There was salsa, which I'd never put that on a baked potato.
Yeah.
There was like raw broccoli, or maybe it was cooked. I don't know because I didn't touch it. Because again, why would you put broccoli. That on a baked potato?
That's just another side. On the
yeah,
side.
Like it's like, you know, that's not even anything fun. That's not a fun side on top of a side. Like if I throw mac and cheese on a baked potato, I'm like, hell yeah, let's fire this carb bomb down. But broccoli, like who puts that on a baked potato?
It has been an option before at like, you know, like your Wendy's.
I know.
So it's like cheddar and broccoli.
What?
Okay.
But anyway, yeah, so, I mean, they probably had 6 to 8 options for things to put on your baked potato. But I remember, like, walking out and being like, oh, baked potato bar, okay. And then looking at it and be like, all right, so my meat options are bacon bits and some, like, runny chili. Which, hey, I can party with some bacon bits and some chili, especially on a baked potato. But again,
as a side,
it's just a baked potato. So I'm glad that you're on my side with this. I'm glad that we have some unity on this podcast.
I lean to the this is a side kind of a thing, and I will say with the caveat that I did have soup for lunch today.
God damn it, Giles. You're lucky I wasn't at work today.
I would have walked right into your office and just sat down and ate that
sat
soup.
Sat at my desk, just stared me in the eyes as you eat a bowl of soup.
A baked potato just... Like, you really got to be piling it in there just for me to consider it as, like, a main course.
Right.
Not a side. And it is very much a Hall of Fame side.
Absolutely.
So, I you know, it is, it's nice that they did that, but that's a side. So, yeah. That's your weird. We're gonna agree on this food take portion of the day. Wow,
who saw that coming?
I'm also relieved we agreed because you were so fired up about this. I was about to be a deer in the headlights.
Now you know how my wife felt when I came home.
it's a little closer than maybe what I said, but yeah, I still put it in the side. So
yeah.
I digress.
All right.
We can probably call that a show and land on that side note. So you can follow Ben on Twitter at Ben Remington for dad jokes, dad photos, hot Stalock takes and the like at Ben Remington. I'm on Twitter at Giles Farrell for your hockey content at Zone Coverage whenever I can get around to it. Might be a little more difficult again this week. It's my birthday week, so that does come with some public appearances and as such. So my my schedule. Oh, and there's another terrible goal. my schedule does get a little, but I will still try to get some out this week. If you haven't, check out my piece last week where I kind of look at bad starts in Wild history for player-wise and then bad team starts in the last decade from an NHL perspective that the Wild kind of fell into and see, you know, is this kind of a hole they can escape. So check that out at zonecoverage.com. Again, if you are so kind as to go to zonecoverage.com/subscribe, use your promo code GATG20 to get $5 off a year subscription to the site, but more importantly, it does help the production of this otherwise fine podcast. iTunes, if you listen on that, please drop us a iTunes rating. Subscribe there as well. SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, Spotify, Google Play, YouTube. We are also on there as well for all your listening needs. And yeah, that will do it for us this week, and we will be back with you next week.
Later.
It's not resiliency. You're making it sound like we're good. That's all. I'm done.